We're with Lord Griffiths of Burry. Lord Griffiths, welcome to Llanelli. Nice to be back.
Beautiful to be back, yes. Get better weather next time.
And you've come for a very special occasion.
Oh yes, I'm going to be talking to old boys of Llanelli Grammar School about associations of this place with the work I do and the life I live, really.
And there's a close link with John Wesley, I believe.
Indeed, yes it is, because I currently preach from John Wesley's pulpit. I am the guardian of John Wesley's bones. He lived and died in the place where I live every day. So it's nice to come to one of the places he came to in his day.
And it's the wonderful portrait here of John Wesley upstairs as well.
It's very good.
Lucky to have in the town.
Yes, indeed. Yes. And I think that the link between Llanelli and London and the beginnings of Methodism is very strong. I'm looking forward to just talking about some of that.
And just quickly, things like this, the Grammar School Boys Association, the Graig Association, very important as a linear line to our past and to our future.
Well, I think that it was a great school and it created fantastic relationships. The people who, of course, went off to do all kinds of things in different places and to pool some of that energy and to draw on some of that experience. Suggests that there are things that we could be doing together that would be of interest not just to ourselves but to everybody else.
And to continue helping others and in the spirit of John Wesley himself.
Absolutely right.
Thank you very much for speaking to me. Thank you.
Councillor Errol Morgan is here. Welcome. The Reverend Eldon isn't yet here, so we'll have to say hi to him when he arrives, if he does. He has another name today, and that's Joseph Chambers, but you'll find more about that later on. And the Reverend D. Yeadon, we welcome you. And also, I think the oldest member of the school that we have here today is Trevor Lewis, so we're delighted to see Trevor. We have a number of apologies. First of all, Lynn Francis, Watkin Thomas, David Parsons, Hugh Griffiths, Peter White, Alan Davis, and Terry Peters aren't able to be with us, although they would have loved to have come along. So we offer their apologies. Now, we have a number of long-distance travellers too. The longest distance traveller of all, who happens by some extraordinary good fortune to be a cousin of mine, and he's come all the way from Vancouver, John Cann. Only just a few minutes ago, I find three other cousins of mine arrived from the other side of the family, and they're in the corner there, the Christophers. So we're delighted to see them. I wish they'd told me they were coming, but there you are. It's good to see them. Then Les Morris, who was the Lord, come all the way from the Midlands. Les, welcome, glad you could come from such a long way away. Across the border from a foreign country, it's very good to see you. Ellis Williams from Gloucestershire, he's here. Ellis, welcome. And Graham Thomas, who is on the right side of the west side of the border from Cardiff. Graham. Glad to see you. Now, we also would like to acknowledge a number of sponsors that have supported today. First of all, Papa Plant, and George is the main instigator there. George, where are you?
He's not here.
He's not here. That's just George. He hands his check in and disappears. And then there's John Bucky has kindly put a contribution in, so we are grateful to John for that. He's our secretary and looks after everything for us. And then there's Quantic Engineering, is a company that Paul Oram is involved with. They've also sponsored the event today. Now, I'm acutely conscious that when there is a main speaker of the caliber of Lord Griffiths, I must keep what I have to say as brief as possible. But they have asked me to announce a number of events that the charity has been holding. And the best way to find out about them is that there is a newsletter that is on each of your seats, and that describes quite well everything that we've been trying to do. The big highlight for us last year was the commemoration event at the old school, which we used to call the new school, where we unveiled plaques to the fallen of the old boys in the First and Second World Wars. And it is extraordinary. Great for us to say that there is now there a permanent war memorial which will be visited in due course in the future by relatives of those who have passed away. we've got we on our fundraising activities. Last year we raised over £6,000. But we don't want to just be a group of old boys that meet and have a very nice dinner once a year. And that's very nice. It's great. But we also like to be active as a charity. And the focus of our charitable work is very much to be local. So we help local young people. We have a sporting bursary. We have various things like that. And we like to keep active. And we're always open to suggestions for charities that we all feel we can enthuse about and support. So that's an ongoing event. But we did raise £6,000. And we awarded that last year, a £3,000 bursary. And I now see that Joseph Chamberlain, the Reverend Eldon has arrived. So welcome, Eldon. Okay. We need to find a seat for him.
Sorry, I'm going to take a seat. There's a seat on the
Okay, now. There are a number of events in the future. One I'd like to pick up on, which will be repeated at the end of the day, but it's a big highlight for us, and that is that there will be an event at the House of Lords in June for old boys of the school. Michael Howard and Lord Leslie, I hope, will be at that event, and we are looking to draw to that occasion, which would be a visit to the House of Lords and a tour and various other things. Old boys who are resident in the area of London and the vicinity, but we also would have people coming up from Connecticut to go to that event. If you'd like to come to that, then please let us know.
Much good work in Swansea. Tethered my horse, enabled me to come here to this fine town of Connecticut in order to meet again, but he's not in. To meet again, Sir Thomas Stepney, the 7th Baronet, who I have christened, excuse the word, I have christened as being a champion of the poor, of the people here of Connecticut. And I know that perhaps you have heard me just across the way there, just outside that ditch gate. This will be my 6th visit to Connecticut. The 6th time that I've addressed the good people of Llanelli 6 times. Thankfully, Mr. Henry Childs has been very kind to myself and has accommodated us in Thomas Street. You know where Thomas Street is?
Yes.
And in fact, has established a little, if I can call it, cell there in his garden. And he's called it a Wesleyan church. What an honour it is for me, the Reverend John Wesley, to have the Wesleyan Church here in this fine town of Llanelli. I have crossed the estuary at low tide, across to a little hamlet called Llanmadoc. You've heard of Llanmadoc?
Yes.
They're going to have some silly vicars there in the future. But never mind, that's Llanmadoc. Llanmadoc. And there I spoke to many. I travel from town to town on a daily basis. I convert as many as I can. My energy perhaps is sapping with old age, but never mind, I will continue on horseback or whatever mode of transport I can get in order to spread the gospel of Christ during these years. It has been a privilege, and it has been an honor. Sir Thomas Stepney has indeed been a great patron here in this fine town of Llanelli. And if I can just say, you might have heard about certain conversion experiences. Nothing to do with rugby, because it hasn't been invented yet. but we will see. I gather, you are gathered here together, Mr. Chairman. You are indeed a chairman. You look fine, man, sir. Are you ripe for conversion? Good! I gather that someone in your presence is going to speak about me today. Is this correct?
Yes. Yeah.
I hope that he puts me in a good light. I hope that this person can remember me as someone who did my best, particularly in this part of Wales. I hope the person who's going to speak to me has an understanding of the method. I'm sure he does. I'm sure he does. And I will leave you now to be informed I'm far too modest to stay and listen about me. I that Lord Leslie Griffiths, who is yet to live for 200 years, never mind, will indeed honour me with what he sees as the truth about my life and my work and my ministry and my passion. Thank you very much indeed, ladies and gentlemen.
Predictable end to such a tirade, as indeed I did yesterday, from somebody who had taken an exception to something I'd said, and it ended by saying, John Wesley would turn in his grave if he knew that you were saying that. And I went out to the graveyard at the back of the chapel where I'm minister. I put my ear to John Wesley's tomb. There was no sound of stirring, and I wrote back, dear madam, I can assure you, John Wesley has not turned in his grave. But he was there, which means I don't believe that that was John Wesley we saw a moment ago. I left him quite safe in London. Anyway, here I am to address you. Not quite the life of John Wesley, which I'm not desperately interested in sharing with you today, but something rather different. And I'll start with something more recent, indeed just last month. I was in Haiti in the Caribbean. We lived there for 10 years at the beginning of my ministry, and I've educated quite a lot of the people who are now the leaders of that country. And it's a desperate country with earthquakes and hurricanes, and you've seen it all in the news. But I had 10 days there because it was the 200th anniversary of Methodism in Haiti. And since I've written the official history of it all, I was there to launch my book, which I had written in English 25 years ago, but a French translation was launched just last month. I mention all this because that work began 200 years ago under the auspices of the Methodist Missionary Society. I was a missionary serving the Methodist Missionary Society. And in 1817, the first two missionaries went and landed in Haiti, and a great, great piece of work, which I'm certainly not going to regale you with, but it was done and begun then. Now, why on earth do I begin in that way? The Missionary Society was founded in 1813, just 4 years before the missionaries went to Haiti, and that has everything to do with our being here today, as I'll reveal to you later. Because it was somebody connected with this town who actually launched the Methodist Missionary Society, which took Methodism to every corner of the earth. There are now 80 million Methodists around the world. It all began with somebody associated not just with here and now, but with this very place. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that I am the minister of Wesley's Chapel. It was built in 1778, but the work had begun 40 years previously and took place in a little place called the Foundry. It was a broken down old factory that had made guns for the Duke of Marlborough fighting against the French. There had been an explosion because they'd done the chemistry wrong, and it had been left a ruin. And John Wesley, the same John Wesley, no, John Wesley, not the same John Wesley. He decided that he wanted to start some work on his own, hired the foundry, did it up, and in a very provisional, haphazard sort of way, began Methodism there. A few years later, 40 years later, the Corporation of the City of London wanted the land back, wouldn't renew the lease, and so he bought, or he leased, a piece of land 200 yards away, just 200 yards, and built the new chapel, as it was called. These days it's called Wesley's Chapel, and I'm the minister there. So the direct successor of John Wesley. I preach from his pulpit every Sunday. He lived and died in a little house on our campus. I passed it on my way out yesterday, that's where he died, March the 2nd, 1791. He's buried behind the chapel. And it's from that part of London, either the foundry or the chapel, that he rode on his horse on the 33 occasions that he visited Ireland. It's an extraordinary thing to think of, doing that. But half the time he came via the southern route, and half the time via the northern route. And every time that he came on the southern route, he always touched in at Llanelli. Llanelli, which was a miserable, wretched little town at that time. And it's not my description, by the way. It's what is said on one of the great panels at Park Howard Museum. So if you have any contention, a bone of contention, have it out with them, not with me. There wasn't much to Llanelli in those days. And three of the visits, he actually stopped here and stayed in this house when Sir Thomas Stepney, as you heard, was the inheritor, the seventh baronet. The first baronet, of course, had married into the Vaughan family, and so great capital interests from London got married to great landowning traditions here in Wales just on the eve. Coal was discovered on the Mansell lands, and the industrial future still lay ahead of Llanelli at that time. And so Wesley came, and it was poised in that way. Sir Thomas Stepney, the seventh baronet, why, he was very accommodating to the Methodist cause. It was between 1769 and 1771 that Wesley came and stayed in this house. At that time, Wesley was at the height of his fame. Absolutely everything. All the early years when there were riots and life-threatening moments, and people, the bishops were railing against the Methodists and saying what a wicked, invidious, nasty lot of people they were. All that was over. He was now becoming the grand old man. I remember going into Heptonstall in Yorkshire when I was the president of the Methodist Conference, riding a horse as John Wesley did, to reenact one incident from the life of Wesley. Now, he went into Heptonstall 13 times in his life. The first time they threw cats, excrement, and sent nasty little boys with stones and catapults out to tell him what they thought of him. I was happy to be reenacting the 13th visit, where on a horse called Velvet, I was led to the town. The town crier rang his bell and said, oh yes, Mr. Wesley's coming. The children were there with their little banners welcoming Mr. Wesley. I had a wig on in those days. I've now passed it on to other Anglican clergymen of more immediate locale. I remember, therefore, the difference between the Wesley who was the object of people's bile and the Wesley who was revered as a public institution. Incidentally, I was once the boss of Donald Soper. And he went through a similar kind of mutation. He morphed from being the enfant terrible, where he would shout his neo-communist stuff in the old narrow tower hill or at the speaker's corner in Hyde Park and get a terrible reputation for it, until he became a grand old man. Three times on the Wogan show equals a quick ticket to heaven. And he was certainly revered in his later years. So I know that mutation very well. But John Wesley built this chapel, and it was from that chapel that he travelled west. As I left it yesterday, the same place to come here as he had left to come here. So I feel very connected with this place in that sort of way. Well, where does all of that leave us? It leaves us with the fact that John Wesley, at the height of his powers, had within his ambit and within his gaze this little town as it was in his life, and he made 12 visits in all. And when he came to this house, he would have fellowship with Sir Thomas Stepney's servants. The butler was one, but other servants too. And this was condoned by Sir Thomas Stepney, who was very, very sort of friendly towards John Wesley. Well, when Sir Thomas died in 1772, of course, he had to go elsewhere, and John Wesley, Redivivus, has told us that that might have been in Thomas Street, as indeed it was, because there was a man there who was an extraordinary man, Henry Childs. We ought to know more about him. Henry Childs was born in Pembrokeshire in 1742.
At the age of 18, 1760, he came into the Stepney household as the agent for the business that was being done from here. But he himself, this lad from Pembrokeshire, had business interests and activities and energies of his own. And soon he was acting as the agent for a number of the companies who were coming here, beginning with coal mining and moving on into shipping. But Childs got in on all of that himself, bought land. He established the Falcon Inn that was over here, just on Gellion, just alongside us here, which was the meeting house for the business class of Llanelli in those days of an emerging town that many of us remember it became at its industrial height. Before copper, of course, but still lots of coal, lots of shipping, and the rest of it. So this Henry Childs was Sir Thomas Stepney's agent. He became a landowner. He got a brewing company together from 1767. He had 9 children, and one of them became his heir and successor eventually. Henry Childs is a revered name in the history of this town, and he figures in those activities that brought what I started with, Haiti, the Methodist Missionary Society, and the story of John Wesley altogether. When Sir Thomas Stepney died, it was necessary to hold the fellowship just over there in Wynne Street, that was demolished to make room for this. Is it Wynne Street?
I lived there.
You lived there?
Yes.
Well, you look as if you're missing it still. thank you, Wynne Street. Well, I did wonder about that, but I saw no poetry where it was at the end of a line that usually allows me to guess which way it's pronounced. So having somebody there is just brilliant. Yes, I hope if I have other mispronunciations, you will not hesitate to intervene in the way that our friend over here has just done. So in Wynne Street, yes, and there was it was his back garden, really. It was where Henry Child got a house. It's just the other side of the church. And so it continued there. And when John Wesley came subsequent to Sir Thomas Stepney's death, it was there that he went, it was there he was received. And on his last visit in 1790, in July, which was only about 8 months before he died, John Wesley was very remarkable, keeping it up until the end, because he was, you know, born in 1703, so we're talking about 87 years of age. He was met by Henry Child and his wife, Mary Jones, a Llanelli girl, although he himself was a Pembrokeshire boy. They said, "We want a chapel, a Methodist chapel here in Llanelli." And John Wesley said, "And so you should have. And I'm going to give you the first down payment. You must do the rest yourselves." And he gave Henry Child, he gave Mary Child, actually, 1 guinea. Well, it was a start, wasn't it? It was a start. And that's how Methodism started its institutional form here in Llanelli, with John Wesley, the man himself, commissioning and condoning the activities of this lay group of people out there just across the other side of the parish church, but which had begun in this very house some years before that. So that's how it began. Henry Childs, with his family and his business interests, very, very active and successful he was. Now I need to go back on myself. I hope you can keep the threads of this story together in your heads. Those of us who consume 2 bottles of red wine at this table are forgiven already if things begin to slip away from them, but I do expect levels of interest elsewhere to be maintained at their very highest. Because I want now to go back to a boy in Lancashire, in Oldham, an Anglican by birth, but at the age of 15, introduced by his mother to the preaching of John Wesley. He became a fanatically devoted acolyte and followed Wesley everywhere from the age of 15 until in the end it was clear that he wanted to be a Methodist minister. And they made him one, and he travelled in various northern towns and had lots of adventures. I mean, his horse fell into a pit during a snowstorm and he could have died of exposure. He was set upon by robbers at another time, and so on and so forth. He was an intrepidly brave man, this lad. But in the end, he became a fully qualified Methodist minister and The church, because John Wesley had just died, sent him in 1794, where? To Swansea. Swansea, he'd never been to Wales before. To cover a circuit, I was talking to Dee just a moment ago, about the Llanelli and Carmarthen circuit, which sounds big enough, it's what I grew up in, which is now being joined to the Pembrokeshire circuit. Well, when this man came along, the circuit was from Llanelli to Chepstow. So we're not unfamiliar with large circuits. And this young man in Swansea, he was there for 1 year, but he decided to come to Llanelli to visit this group that I've mentioned about. And so he came on foot from Swansea, and he had to cross the River Lacher. They told him at low tide you could walk over it. But when he tried to walk over it, of course, he couldn't, because he got into the wrong place, he kept his eyes on the wrong landmark, and he was soon in quicksands, and they had to haul him out. They were lucky there were people passing by. They hauled him out, so bedraggled, wet, covered in sand. He completed the 4 miles from Lacher to Llanelli, and was entertained by the Childs over there in Wind Street. and cared for by the oldest daughter called Maria. Well, there's something about being nursed by someone called Maria. and certainly his heart beat a little faster, and this young Methodist minister fell in love with Maria. But soon, his year was over, he'd recovered well, and off he went to serve further afield, in Brecon, first of all, and then in other places too. And 4 years later, he came back to claim the hand of Maria, and they got married in 1798. So we have this couple, now a Methodist minister and his wife, the son-in-law and daughter of Henry Childs, the man who had been the agent of Sir Thomas Stepney, and who in this very place had done so much of his work. The stories are beginning to come critically together. But now, this young man and his wife are elsewhere. The two oldest Methodist, English Methodist churches in Wales were both built by him. He was an architect of so much of early Methodism in South Wales. But he was now out of the country. The family of Henry Childs, meanwhile, was progressing nicely with its business interests, and there were other children that came along to replace Maria after she'd gone off with the preacher. But in Leeds, it is getting complicated, isn't it? In Leeds, this young preacher and his wife become now favoured with a superintendency, which is a kind of higher kind of minister who has charge of other ministers. I'm a superintendent minister myself, in Leeds. And it was decided that Methodism had now grown so strong that it needed to think about organizing its work overseas. And the Methodist Missionary Society was begun. It was begun with a sermon preached by the young man married to Maria Childs. It was he who preached the first sermon. It was he who oversaw the formation of the Methodist Missionary Society, which, as I've said, has been the instrument for taking Methodism to the furthest corners of the earth. And this young man's name, of course, you'll all have guessed it by now, was James Buckley. James Buckley married to Maria Childs. Well, eventually he came back to Wales, lived in Carmarthen for a while, but poor Henry Childs, he had all those children and all those business interests, and all his children died, one after another. There was one boy left in whom the business was to be continued, but he too died. And so the only heir, when in 1824, Childs died, the only heir was Maria. So all the business of Henry Childs passed to James Buckley and his wife Maria. The brewing business, as well as all the other interests as well. It's just an extraordinary, extraordinary story, because one of the things Methodism was good at was telling everybody how bad beer was. And a kind of ironic moment as the pigeon comes home to roost. For a while, James Buckley was still in hard work. as a minister. But he had one son, and he asked the son to run the business, although he and Maria had to see the accounts every single day, the accounts of the business. And then when James Buckley himself retired, shortly afterwards he took over the business and was head of the business until he died. I think that's just a brilliant, brilliant story. So you have James Buckley, a prominent Methodist. Let me just tell you, he was 8 years on the staff of Wesley's Chapel, where I am now the superintendent. So this James Buckley touches my life and places where I have been more than once, as a missionary and in Wesley's Chapel. Henry Childs, in the story of Methodism at Llanelli, is the one who's often forgotten. And yet he is actually the architect of it all. John Wesley, who visited 12 times, actually on his last time, launched the Methodist Church here. And Hall Street, can I see the spire from here? Chapel just there, which is the third chapel on the, we're not quite on the side. Wyndham Street isn't quite that Hall Street.
Can I ask a question? What's Jerusalem?
Coming to it. Was Jerusalem built in here? In Wales's green and pleasant land. It was, because they went onto this site, they sold for £20,000, they sold the old Wesleyan church to the Welsh Methodists, and they called it Jerusalem.
Oh, no.
Right, so you had Welsh-speaking Methodists in Wynd Street.
Yes.
You're winding me up, you are. And you had English-speaking Methodists in Hall Street. And don't anybody tell me that Hall Street is pronounced in any other way. I know that a double L in Welsh, so I'm very careful about it. No, but that's it. Hall Street, when it was built here, it was the third constructed church for the Methodists in Llanelli. And you can see that it is not like other chapels. It looks more like an Anglican church with a nave and aisles and a spire and all the rest of it. And of course the architect was James Wilson of Bath. And he was married to Mary Buckley, the granddaughter of James Buckley. So all of that seems to me to be a slice of Llanelli history occasioned by all that this house represented in the emerging history of this time. And I thought that rather than tell you a boring old biography of John Wesley himself, I'd spin out these extrapolations and make a picture out of the whole that far more directly affects the fabric, the ethos, and the emerging character of this lovely town of Llanelli, when of course it was spelled with a Y at the end and not an I. But it was still pronounced Llanelli. So thank you very much indeed. It's lovely, lovely, lovely to be with you.
To give us thanks.
I'll stop that. Right. Ken said, someone's going to do a vote of thanks. Here's to my hand. Oh, you do it. But it's turned out to be a happenstance. Leslie and I were in the same Latin class, and we both ended up here a bit later than me at the same Cambridge College. And also, Leslie's been whipped by a former girlfriend of mine.
After you'd been whipped by that.
Yes, that's right. Where did we go wrong? Leslie's been a fantastic supporter of this organisation. I first heard him speak at the Tom's Arms on a cold January day. He came to our second centenary dinner and gave the most inspiring speech we've heard, I think, in the whole history of the association. And he came last year and dedicated the plaque for us. So that was fabulous. And today he's given us another wonderful speech and truly stimulating this experience, and I think we all just say thank you very much. It's fantastic.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's so great to have Lord Leslie Griffiths here today. I've been in correspondence with him as we've been organising this event, and his great predecessor. It seems to be a common theme amongst the Methodist faith that people travel great distances. He's been in Texas, he's been in Haiti, and you know, it's amazing the part of the world he's visited in the space of probably about 6 or 8 weeks. Obviously, the success of today, I think, is very much due to his presence and what he's told us, what he shared with us today about the roots of our community, and obviously the community that we're also proud of. So in recognition of your contribution today, Lord Griffiths, we'd like you to accept are there any more boys and girls who are still yet to pay here? I think there's only one or two, is it? I think everyone's paid basically at this point. Whatever, is it?